How is everybody today? I see so many new faces. It's very nice. Welcome. I am Leia Edwards. I am the General Director of Holy City Arts and Lyric Opera here in Charleston, South Carolina. Filling in today for the ever so handsome and vibrant Dimitri Pitas, Artistic Director of Halo. And we have a very special guest and beginning of a very special series here today for Opera 101. Today begins our series called Devouring Opera from Soup to Nuts with Mr. William Berger. He is going to take us through a series of classes that will explain all you ever wanted to know about opera, from composers to terminology to why do we listen to this art form anyway. Will has written on a variety of subjects, including architecture, religion, and sports. He is the author of several books and numerous articles and has been a familiar voice on radio for over 20 years. He is a commentator for the Metropolitan Opera and is heard on Met Opera Radio's Sirius XM broadcasts and the podcast series In Focus, and is responsible for the Met's opera quiz. I don't think we're doing one of those today, but we might. He's a keen and active supporter of new music in a variety of genres and frequently produces and hosts live music events in New York City. If you look him up on Wikipedia, there is a very handsome ginger gentleman, it turns out, whose name is also William Berger. But our handsome William Berger joins us now today. So Will, it is it is with great pleasure that I get to introduce you today. Thank you for being here, and I will let you take it away.
Thank you, Leia. Am I on? Is everybody hearing me? Is somebody nod? Okay, great. I'm not that William Berger whose picture is there. There is another one in the opera world. He's a South African baritone. I'm not, but thank you, Leia, and thank you everybody for being here. I know there are a lot of demands on people's Zoom time these days, and I appreciate you spending it with us here and with the Halo people of Charleston, who one of my favorite places in the country. So hello to everyone in Charleston, and I can't wait to visit when that becomes a thing again. I was there for Spoleto, but now I'll just come down for Halo, and that'll be even better. And I believe there is going to be, these classes are free, which is marvelous. And I mean, I don't even like the term classes, but for lack of a better one. And I believe there is, Ashley just put in chat a sort of tip jar. So please feel free to throw some spare change in there, because as we're going to discuss right now, one of the problems, and I say problems in a good way, like the way your lit teacher might have said, you know, the problems in a Shakespeare play, that's the interesting part. One of the problems with opera is it's really expensive to produce, to enjoy, it's an expensive thing to exist. And I'm sure Leia could tell you in great detail some phenomenal stories about that. But trust me on it, and drop some change there if you can. What we're doing today, I'm not going to give an opera quiz, which is something, that's an interesting thing, the Met Opera quiz. This is our 80th season of it. I'm running out of questions. But today, what we're doing is, it's an intro to the series, but it's an important intro, I think. And it's an intro for everybody. If you've never dealt with opera, you need to be here. If you are a know-it-all, if you're the kind of guy who, I said guy, usually is, but not always, who would email me during a broadcast and say, no, you're wrong, I love you, and you're in the right place too. Because We all need to talk about the basics right now, kind of check our mission. What is this stuff? Why is it the way it is? And what does it have to do with me? Or to, let me see if I can get the grammar right. To whom does it refer? And we all need to do that. And right now is a moment between seasons for everybody. Leia said that I produce new music at live events in New York. Not now, I don't. No one does. Maybe soon, maybe not. I don't know. But it is a moment. I've been working with a lot of different opera companies on councils and stuff to sort of say, where are we now? What happens when we come back? What do we preserve? What has to change? And so on. I think it's true for all of us, the audience, potential or otherwise, to take this moment also to say, what's all this stuff about? Now, I was giving a talk in Canada, as a matter of fact, and I was going through, I had a very elaborate chart of how to unpack opera, you know, and what to do with it. And I was very proud of this whole chart I had come up with. And there was this student sitting in the front row, a lot of people there in Winnipeg. And he was a literature student, as I had been too, that's my background. And he said, all you're saying is just basically intro to literature. And I was about to get all, you know, squared off at him. And then I realized, yes, you're right. That's exactly it. Let me go with that. Not in terms of being a literary critic, but the way we all interpret a text. You have to look at it and say, what is it? Is this a technical manual that's going to tell me how to plug in my computer? Or is it a novel, War and Peace? Or is it something else? Any number of things. And you need to engage with the text in order to make it come alive. And that's the same thing I advocate for this opera thing. The same thing. If everything's a text, then think of opera as a text. And you engage with it and interpret it to a certain extent. You're an active person in it. Now, there are a lot of ideas out there saying what this stuff is, what this art form is. And most of them are wrong at best. And a lot of them are half right, which is truly wrong. So it's time to look at our preconceptions of what this stuff is. And this is for everybody too. And really look at them critically. There are a lot of people, Dimitri repeated this in some Instagrams, there are a lot of people who want to tell you, who are invested in telling you that you have no place in this world. And there are people on all sides. There are people who hate opera who will tell you it's this way and that way. And there are people who like it for themselves and act as gatekeepers that will tell you why this is not for you. They're all of that is wrong, and we'll get to that too today. What I want to start is, first of all, a definition, one that I think we all need to rethink or revisit. There is a thing called opera, specific art form, and it is not a form of music. Opera is a form of drama. Write that down if you're taking notes. Opera is a form of drama in which the main means of communicating the idea, the information, but absolutely not the only means, but the main means is singing. There is no style of music called opera. There's no style of singing. She sings operatically. Doesn't mean anything. When people say it, register that they're not saying anything. It's like gourmet deli. It doesn't mean anything. That's a New York thing, but you get the idea. Garden fresh, that says in the supermarket, doesn't mean anything. All cultures have forms of using music for storytelling. All cultures, from Neanderthal times at least until the present and everywhere. But there is this thing that we call opera, and it's a very specific form. And it did not grow organically. It was invented as a project by a bunch of people, academics, who didn't even know what they had just invented. They didn't know what to call it. So they called it in their language, which happened to be Italian, a work. The word was opera, opera. Now, every marketing department in the world will not want me to say what I just said, because they want to emphasize that, oh, opera is for all people. But I think we need to acknowledge that it is a weird art form, and always was, that was invented as a project very briefly, because I love to go off on this. It happened to be the year 1597 in Florence, Italy, and a bunch of academics sat around and said that people had been rediscovering Greek drama in the Renaissance. And they knew that to some extent, these great, great dramas, tragedies and comedies, but mostly those tragedies, Aeschylus and Euripides and the other Sophocles, were to some extent sung. We know from statues, we know from comments about it, sung, but how much? And we know that rhythm played a part, that when you were doing praise to the gods, you would do it in a certain rhythm. Bum, bum, bum. I think that's a dithyramb. I'm not even sure. But they saw pictures of musicians. They said, what was it like? And the genius that they had in Florence in the 16th century that not too many other places would have had was, as academics, instead of saying, what did it actually sound like? Because there's no way of knowing, we still don't know. They said, how can we find a sound for it with what we have at our disposal to get to the wonderfulness of what they had? They hired one of their members was a composer, and they said, and one of their members was a poet. They said, you guys get together and come up with something. And boom, they sat there like, I imagine, remember the old print ad with the guy sitting in front of the speakers and his hair blowing back? I imagine they sat there like, oh dear, what have we done? Have we opened Pandora's box? And they invented opera. Ashley, can we see that picture again? Because it's interesting, there's some information. We have a program from this. It happened to be called La Daphne, the first picture, yeah. And there is an existing program, and they brought it back 3 years later. And you'll notice a couple of things. First of all, they wrote it in Italian, not in Greek. Secondly, the poet, this is a different Daphne. I put up the wrong picture. Doesn't matter. Within 3 years, another composer was writing the same thing. The poet, Jacopo, I think that says Cuda, was equally important. Now Rinuccini, this is very interesting, we're jumping ahead here, but they took a Greek myth, but they told an Italian story. But I think it's important that it was a myth, and there's a lot of unconscious psychology in the Greek myths, or they were interested in that, as Freud would be later. And so music could explore that. Now we had, interestingly, Rinuccini came up, he had a daughter who was a good singer, as another composer, Caccini, had, who wrote another opera. And they wanted to write music that should, look what my daughter can sing. Whoa, whoa. And the poets were saying, no, we shouldn't do that. And this whole battle of music versus word that could be very exciting when there's a clash of egos there, began right at the beginning. Another thing we know, in 1600, another Caccini wrote another opera. I think it was Euridice. I can never say it. It's an Orpheus myth. Half of operas are based on Orpheus, either directly or indirectly. More on which later. The founder of musical theater, that myth. In 1600, there was a royal wedding, a very big royal wedding. Maria de Medici married the guy who would become king of France, or maybe he already was. And Caccini wrote an opera, Euridice, as part of the entertainment. So this is in 3 years after this whole form being invented. And already what we know is, we know there are issues with words versus music, and we know this stuff is really expensive and difficult to produce. You need a royal wedding and a royal treasury or some equivalent to pay for it. And I think that's interesting. Now, I mentioned before, I want to talk about in this course, who is it for? A little story here. I was at the gym a couple years ago, and there was this guy that I knew from there, much younger, college student, very frat boy, right? And he said, I said, what do you do? I'm in school, great. He said, what do you do? And I said, you know, oh, well, I'm the commentator for the Metropolitan Opera. And he said, oh, you know, yeah, opera never really resonates with my generation, or never really resonated with my generation. And I said, hey, you idiot. Do you think it resonated with mine? Like, I may be older than you. I may be significantly older than you, but I'm not 300 years older than you. I grew up in the 1970s in LA, where there was no opera company, on the wrong end of LA. And I don't know if there's a right end of LA, but I wasn't in it. The point being that nobody, not even, and now I am this, an old white guy, as I was told in a conference last week. Never saw that one coming, but here I am. None of us was given a red carpet to the opera world. It is a stretch for everybody, intellectually, financially, socially. There is no opera class in this country. So any of us, there was a little bit in Charleston 250 years ago, and there was a little bit in New Orleans 250 years ago. Not much. And that certainly is none of us now, even if some of those were your great-great-great-grandparents. All of us from 1597 to everybody else have had to take a big journey to get to opera from wherever they were. So if you feel like this doesn't resonate with people like me, it's like, no, it doesn't, and it never will. But you still have a place there. Eventually, you're going to learn to think for yourself and think for yourself in terms of your artistic, what you consume, I hope. And that's when you come here, whoever you are. Okay. Why is it the way it is? There, as I said, there's no style of music called opera, but we know for, it so happens that the means of telling a story primarily, but not exclusively, through singing work really, really well with the ways they had of making music in primarily Italy, but also other places in Europe and elsewhere, from about 1780 to 1920. There are lots of operas before that. There are lots of operas after that, things that we call operas, from places far from Italy. But it so happens that the methods they had, many of which were defined by what they had available, by economic realities, by technological realities, we're going to look at that real quickly, in Italy and France and Germany to a certain extent, and other places in Europe to a certain extent, primarily Italy, from about 1780 to about 1920, worked really, really well with this format. And one of the reasons, there are vocal traditions that worked well. Vocal traditions, many that primarily grew up out of churches that had very similar needs and requirements. How do we make people understand what we're singing all the way over there? We want as many people as possible. If you've ever been in a big cathedral, you know the problems. You know that you have to work reverb into it. You can't go too fast because it just turns into mush. So we think of spiritual music as being kind of stately and slow, or from that tradition. People in the Caribbean have other traditions just because of the acoustics. You also needed to get a certain amount of pitch. And there's a very interesting thing. A high voice cuts through the acoustics of a room better. It doesn't have to be louder to be heard. Now that's interesting. And that's interesting when you have the physics of human beings. So you have women who in many places were not allowed on stage, more on which in a moment, but the fact was composers needed that voice in order to create these stories. So it has been said that the first place in the Western tradition where women earned their own fortunes independent of any men was in opera. Not spoken drama, which as we know in say England, women weren't even permitted to play women's roles until much after say Shakespeare and some other great playwrights, much later. So opera composers needed women. That changed things. There was also this thing called the castrato, which is really, really interesting, and I could go on and on and on, but I can't, but right now, but just real quickly, these were men who were surgically altered as boys before puberty in order to preserve their high pitch of voice. And they had strength of a male voice, which has more decibels, but pitch of a woman's voice. But there, it was neither male nor female, nor a child, nor an adult. It was all of those things. And they were flat out the greatest singers that have ever been heard. We know that from the music written for them. It's also completely barbaric and unthinkable. It also was a box office sensation, and not just in Italy. So we have, the way I see it, it's the highest ideals, artistic ideals, and the lowest barbaric traditions of Europe in one place, in the opera. And I think that's interesting. They were a thing, they passed out of history, but they are part of our story of how it got like this. The idea is, just as in church, where they had started, presumably, the idea is, I need to get people to understand the story I'm telling within the technological limits. You had language issues. I said we started this in Italy, and as we're going to see in a moment, it took off, this tradition took off in Venice. They used Italian. Now, that's one of the problems between you and opera, you as an American and opera. People will tell you, oh, well, how, I'm not, I can't understand the words. It's like, well, do you know that people never could to a certain extent? It's really important to remember that Venetians in the 17th century did not speak Italian was their second language if they spoke it at all. Venetian, which if you've ever dealt with it, is not like Italian at all. There are words, there are words that are all vowels. It's crazy. I love it. But we'll see in a moment, The Marriage of Figaro was written for Vienna in Italian for an audience, average audience member there in the theater of Venice, not at the court, but in the theater of Vienna. I mean, there was less Italian understood there than probably at a New York opera house today. The average, I'm not getting this right grammatically, but your average audience in New York today would know more Italian than the average audience in Vienna in 1786 would have known. So there's something going on about the language that, yes, for a long time they were all written in Italian. Even Germans and other people wrote operas in Italian for a while. And then in French and German and Russian and Czech, that's fabulous. And English, of all crazy languages, and more, Gullah, as we'll get to in a moment. Language works differently here. It's not a literal art form. It is not a barrier to you if you don't know Italian or Czech or Gullah. Because the music conveys the information acoustically as well as syntactically. There are orchestra, then there's this whole thing of the orchestra, and that grew because of technology. But let's look at theaters for a moment. Ashley, give me a slide there. I've got two to compare here, if I'm on the right slide. I sent you the right one. Yeah. Okay, so look at this. There's a model, they're thinking of rebuilding it, of the first box office theater. People have corrected me and said that Shakespeare and the Globe were box office theater, and that's true about 30 years before this in a somewhat different way. But the box office as we know it largely was invented here as an opera house in Venice, which I find very interesting, at the San Cassiano. There is still a theater in Venice that is about this size. It was later in that century. Century now called the Malibran Theater. Very interesting place, well worth a visit. I saw the worst ballet I've ever seen there, but anyway, they were all drunk. It was something. Anyway, but there is a great intimacy to these theaters. You'll see the horseshoe shape. The audience, remember, they couldn't dim the lights, they had candles. So you're going to look at each other, you're going to, and that means you respond to things in a different way than when you're sitting in the dark. Comedy works better in a theater like this. Comedy works better when the audience sees itself laughing. I'm here to tell you know, comedy at a big, at the Metropolitan Opera in the dark with 4,000 people, it's hard to pull off. It's really hard. But okay, so they had this going and they sold tickets at the box office. Now that means not only did Venetians have to sit there in Italian and strain to understand it like they were in school, but 1637 in Venice, that means they're selling to the tourist trade. That means tourists are keeping opera going. It's the thing to do when you go to Venice, which at the time was a pleasure city, the brothel of Europe. You went there to gamble, you went there for the masked balls and all this from all over. And one of the things you did, the way they pitched it, was go to the opera. There were 23, I think, box office driven opera houses in Venice by the late 17th century. Now, what you had in operas such as this was a couple of leads. Probably no chorus at all, or if there was one, it was at the end that jumped in. And literally, you got the stage hands and whoever else they could get at the end, you know, put on a sheet and sing. And they all lived happily ever after, like as a punctuation. You had an orchestra of about 15 or 20, including a lute or a theremin bow, those wonderful things. Things that could, very delicate instruments, people could hear them, and so on. Fast forward. Oh, I should have put a date there. I meant to. Well, very interestingly, the San Carlo Theater of Naples is exactly 100 years after the San Casciano. A beautiful theater. Definitely visit it if you go to Naples. It's the prototype for every theater for another 200 years after that. Now, you see something really interesting there. If you look, you can barely see it, but in the middle of the auditorium, up on one floor, the piano nobile, the noble floor, you will see a royal box. Naples was a royal city. There was a king of Naples. In fact, his name was Carlo, which is why it's the Teatro San Carlo. What does St. Charles have to do with an opera house? Especially that St. Charles Borromeo, who is very austere in an opera house like this, which is beautiful. Well, was the patron saint of the king, so the king is paying the bill. This theater serves to glorify the king. You go there and you're there and your first impression is, wow, our king is great to provide us with this. And that's what it's designed for. You can always, always see the king in this. He's paying the bills. Somebody has to. And it's very interesting because actually this has nothing to do with anything, but it is an interesting story that talks about this. In 1855, we have, fast forward to Paris, Emperor Napoleon III and his wife, the Empress Eugenie, who had a lot of relationship to opera in many weird ways. Get to that. 1855, they had a big World's Fair in Paris, big exhibition. And Queen Victoria and her husband, Prince Albert, came for a visit, a royal state visit. So, of course, the first thing that had to be planned was a trip to the opera. Paris Opera, not the present theater, but a big poofy one. And because in Paris, then as now, the state runs the theaters. And in fact, they hired Verdi to compose an opera for it. Les Vespres Siciliennes, the Sicilian Vespers. Big, honkin', fabulous opera. Anyway. And both royal couples showed up and everybody looked at them and applauded and all that. And what everybody noticed was Queen Victoria, who was the legitimate Queen of England by right, by divine right, sort of. They come in, they bow to the audience, and she backed up and sat down in the royal box. The Empress Eugenie, who was a Spanish and American, believe it or not, woman, who everyone said, like, is she really an empress or is that just a political thing? Did what any one of us would do. She turned around and made sure the chair was there and sat down. And everybody knew that she was not legitimate as a monarch the way Queen Victoria was. Because the Queen of England, knowing that she was the Queen of England, didn't need to turn around. She knew that as the Queen of England, someone would put a chair there. If you see the movie The Queen with Helen Mirren, there's a point, she's like the best actor in the world. There's a point where she has to take a phone call in the kitchen in Balmoral in Scotland, in her country place. And they hand her the phone and she sits without looking. And I went, oh my God, she's read that. She knew that thing about Queen Victoria at the opera in Paris. You can't do it. You cannot do it unless you're born to it. It's like the princess and the pea. Point being, for our purposes, that the person who pays for this creates a space where they are glorified, along where the work glorifies them. If it's not going to be the king or the queen, you might have, as in Milan, the nobility had a committee that ran the opera house. At La Scala, that was until the 1920s, when Toscanini from the Metropolitan Opera came in and said, no, we're done with that. The city is going to pay for it. The city of Milan. And they do. That's what you had in Charleston. You had the landowners that said, we need a place where we can look at each other. And you built the Dock Theater, Dock Street Theater, which is like my favorite theater in the world, but that's beside the point. And as that changed, the logistics changed of the theater and the works changed. Now, for some clips, what can this stuff do? In other words, why bother with this? Why bother with all this fuss and expense? Because there are certain things that this art form does, there are certain insights it gives you that no other art form does, or that it gives you in a unique way. Let's look at a few. This form can penetrate layers of human thought that spoken drama, movies, books can't, just with that layer of music and what is spoken and unspoken. Opera can play with time in a weird way. And here's a clip I want to show you that we were talking about, what clip should we use? And kind of all three of us came up with, da, 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 da. What about Figaro Act Two finale? And I said, oh, wait, you mean the best thing ever written? Let me tell you what's going on here really quickly, and then you see how it works. What's going on here is a domestic comedy where everybody has a secret. And everybody's trying to lie, and everybody's trying to tell a partial truth to shut everyone else up. And they're thinking, but I thought you said the letter, you sent the letter. Well, I did, but I sent the other letter. But who did you send it to? And so on and so forth. And what's interesting is, I mentioned that there's the orchestra. Listen to the orchestra. Because the unifying part, the rhythm section, is the orchestra. The melody is in the orchestra, and the words, this is the difference between opera and song, or most songs. The words are kind of sprinkled on top of the logic that is the unspoken, and it's clicking in time. And let's have a listen to this.
Che fare? Si manca. abbastanza. Suoni a ti confondi.
Why does that have to end? I can say a lot about that. What is that, a minute and a half or 2 minutes? 2 minutes. It seems like a whole afternoon, and it seems like 10 seconds, which is another thing, the fluidity of time when you get music in it. But we'll talk more about that next time with Mozart, and a lot more. But that's from 1786, again, written in Italian for an audience that understood less Italian than most today's audiences do. And it was big box office, The Marriage of Figaro. More on which later. But some interesting things about kind of the thinking was the melody. And what was said was kind of the interjections. Opera can also, moving on, really explore the world of what is not said. And there's a wonderful, wonderful example, another 1 minute long aria. Let's have this one from 1762, I think. Ephigénie en Tauride of Gluck. Some of my favorite things in the world, and I love that production because they're playing with what's going on. Now, what's going on there, I didn't tell you before, but now I will. First of all, it was Rodney Guilfrey. Was it? Yes. Yay, Rodney Guilfrey. Was a good friend of mine. I haven't seen him lately. This is Orestes from Greek mythology. He's about to be sacrificed, killed. And he says, I'm calm. Calm is back in my heart. I'm calm. No, really, I'm fine. No, really, I'm fine. The orchestra is giving us not just different information, but telling us he's not fine. It's exactly how that really feels when you're saying, No, I'm fine. Really, I'm fine. No, why would you think I'm not? Of course I'm. But he's an absolute wreck. So that to have when Hamlet has to say, I know exactly what I'm going to do, and then I'm not going to do it. It takes Shakespeare what 14,000 words to, and he does it brilliantly, but he has to do it in a different way. Here we have in 1 minute, I'm fine. I'm not fine. I'm fine. I'm not fine. And that's how it feels. I love that. So that was Rodney. By the way, in the other clip, in the Figaro clip, that was Bryn Terfel many years ago. He just looks like Meatloaf. It wasn't Meatloaf. He often jokes about how he's mistaken for Meatloaf all the time. He's not. But Bryn Terfel was the other one. Okay. So we're playing with what's said and what isn't said. Opera, like mythology, that which was founded, and sacred music, with which it's very closely related, has a different view of gender than literal art forms. Women play men play women. Women play men more often, but whatever. So there's that. And it can provide multiple, this is a kicker. You can have multiple points of view unpacked simultaneously in opera. You cannot do that in anything where you're relying on understanding the words. So we'll get to choral and the whole group dynamic, but multiple people's dynamics. We saw a little of that in the Figaro, but they were all kind of in the same place. What about when people are in different places? What's the overview? It's a point of view you cannot have anywhere else. And one of my favorite moments of this, and I know Ashley loves this too. Okay, wow, how am I gonna get this plot? Okay, very quickly, let's see how I can do this. The tenor's not in any of these scenes, by the way, more on which in a moment, but our baritone is married to our soprano. She's in love with the tenor who we won't meet, and they may or may not be having an affair. They're not, but okay. The baritone, meanwhile, wants to kill the tenor because he's the king and because he's sleeping with his wife, or he thinks. Whatever, he wants to kill the tenor because baritones kill tenors. And he has two conspirators who are going to kill him, who want in on the murder. And in the middle of, like, the wife is saying, wait a second, I think they're going to kill this man who I love, even though I'm not sleeping with, because I shouldn't, but I love him. And all this tension keeps building. It goes from an aria to a trio to a quartet. And then a soprano, as a boy, because you can do that, comes in and says, just at that moment, I'm here to invite you from the king to a masked ball, which is the name of the opera, Un ballo in maschera. And it'll be so great, and oh, my lady, you're going to be the belle of the ball, and oh, won't it be great? And so the music that would sound like foof on its own has the context of this conspiratorial murder plot. And the music actually becomes something else because of that context. And we're going to, I wish we could play the whole scene, but imagine that they're like, right before this comes, oh my God, we're going to kill him. Yes, take an oath. Kill the king. Kill the king. Boom. Hit it, Ashley.
Anche il sire vi sarà,
certo,
forse, tanto invito so che valga.
È un ballo in maschera, splendidissimo.
Benissimo. Ella a me poi interverrà.
Ma
me! E poi con sera quella vita, più spedito è tuo.
Spend an hour just talking about that. I really do. Yes, that was Riri Grist stealing the show as Oscar the Page Boy, as she did. And Ashley, is that Cappuccilli, Piero Cappuccilli, and Katia Ricciarelli? And who was conducting? Was that Abbado? Oh, yeah, well, yeah. Okay, on that, because the conductor, like, the overview, anyway. Okay, what if you notice there that Oscar had the little foof theme, which, like, one could be very pretty, but under the circumstances, if you've ever gotten a tattoo, that's what they feel like. Then the music that the soprano and the baritone sang directly after was in fact the natural harmony, the natural harmonic counterpoint. Counterpoint is not the right word because the high soprano has the counterpoint, but the underlying themes in a minor harmony. But it's the same music. It's a variation on the theme. Now, when you have at the piano, theme and variations, this is a form that a lot of great pianists, composers worked with, Tad and Baroque, and Beethoven, Brahms, maybe the most famous. And, you know, they'll lay out a theme, and then you have all the variations. It doesn't have to be at the piano, you know. And then, you know, all the different ways. When you do the theme and variations in an instrument, you have all the different ways the mind can interpret a set of dots, a set of notes, intervals, spaces between pitches. When you master that with voices, I'm just going to say right now, no one in history has ever known the human voice, this thing, better than Giuseppe Verdi. It just happened that way. I said it, fight me. When you have the human voice doing that, What you get in theme and variations is the entire reaction from a human being, emotional, visceral, to a given bit of information. And then the minor variation, right? And that the cellos, Verdi loved the cello. Whenever you hear the cello, he's saying, pay attention, I'm saying something important. It's a deeper point of view than you can get anywhere else. Not only that, it's scientifically profound because if the music is changed by who is hearing it and the context, what you have is Heisenberg's uncertainty principle in music. In other words, you feel it. The thing is changed by being heard. And Verdi was doing this 100 years before Heisenberg. Real quick, the other thing about voice, just in, well, all right, let's have one more clip. I know we're pushing it on time, but in Christian scripture, you may have come across the line, the Spirit says, with sighs, that which is too deep for words. Well, sigh is breath, spira, voice. If you think of that as voice, we have a good example here, and it's a soprano, and it's an iconic moment. And Ashley, let's have a minute of this. Was Kirsten Flogstad in the movie The Big Broadcast of 1938, introduced no less by Bob Hope, who says she's now going to sing an aria, pronounced that way. That's not an aria, but never mind that. We'll get to that. Now, you notice we didn't have any subtitles there. She's not saying anything. She's saying hoya toho, which now means hoya toho, but Wagner invented it. It's nonsense words. It's not the words that matter here. I mean, they matter, but it's the sound of them. That what do we know from that? That's the first time we meet Brünnhilde, who's going to be the star of the biggest opera ever written, The Ring of the Nibelung, four parts. Turns out to be all about her. And that's when we meet her. It's a heck of a way to walk on stage. But when you have, I mean, the way he did it doesn't matter, but you know just from the jumps and the leaps and the volume and the, well, she kind of cheated a few times. That doesn't matter. It was absolutely convincing. But the trills and the technique, this is not the girl next door. We meet the girl next door in other operas, La Bohème, where you have little intervals between the notes. Da 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 da. These are people that you know. They build their music the way we build our conversation. Brünnhilde knows. She walks in, ho to ho, watch what I can do. Boom, she's blowing you away. She's carrying a spear. She's poking you with the spear as she's singing. Not in every production, but you know, traditionally. So you know that this is a goddess woman, and in fact a warrior goddess, because her music is disturbing and it makes your blood flow, not always in a nice way. Sort of in a, oh my God, why is she screaming at me? It's using the voice, and in fact, no more clips, but opera gives, not only tells us who people are by their voice, their spira, their spirit, the unseen part of them, but the heard part of them. It gives voice to those who have no voice, which can be very politically subversive. For example, yes, I didn't even know I had I forgot that I had a slide here. So in a good way, I'm thinking of Pat Nixon and John Adams's Nixon in China in 1987. Who ever heard Pat Nixon say things? Who ever knew what she was thinking all the time, right? And in opera, there's a wonderful moment in Nixon in China right after this where she's alone and it's snowing and she just imagines, you know, a better world is possible. And your hair blows back because it's like, wow, I never thought I'd get an insight onto what Pat Nixon might have been thinking that day or any day. So she gets voice, the voiceless gets beautiful voice there. But also, you know, very bad people. And here we have Iago on the left, who is very, very bad in the opera, even worse than he is in Shakespeare's play Othello, with some nice tenor. I don't recognize him, but he's very handsome. Oh, wait, could that be Dimitri Pitas? Oh, yeah. As Cassio, not as Othello, because he's the nice guy here. But he sends Cassio out the door and says, Vanne, go away. And the orchestra thunders chords. Bum, bum, bum. Chords that summon devils in the Middle Ages. Bad guy chords. And you know what Shakespeare could not tell you. The scene doesn't exist in Shakespeare. It's like, my nature is evil. I am evil. I am the devil. I am evil walking on two legs. And he does a prayer, a perversion of the Christian credo, where he says, I believe in a cruel God who created me in his own image. Because as things are set up in the world of opera, you have an aria where no one's on stage and someone is sharing their inner thoughts. You're not supposed to believe they're actually singing at you. That's Gilbert and Sullivan. That's something else. That's another tradition. Here you can do that or do this is inner thoughts. He doesn't even want us to know what he's saying. And that happens in the credo where he says, like, the idea is, I can't believe I'm saying this. I hope God doesn't hear me, you know, but it's revealed to us through music. So opera can do that. Voice to the voiceless. Fine. Why does everybody tell you this stuff isn't for you, no matter who you are? There are, that it's too elite. Well, I told you, somebody had to pay for it. So a lot of times the king or the nobility took on, said, we own this place and we'll set the rules. It's not the case now. And it only was the case because of the economic realities. It was true of food too. The good food was owned by the king and the nobility. But, you know, we'd rather have good food than bad food. So the way we don't worry about, well, it's going to make me foofy to have better food than rotten food, like what the peasants used to eat, it's the same thing going on here. And similarly, you know, well, I mean, people will tell you, well, it's affected. It's in a foreign language. Well, same thing with coffee. You learned how to say cappuccino because it tastes better than bad coffee. So it's worth maybe throwing in some, if you want, opera has a language the same way wrestling has a language and golf and everything else. So if you have to throw in some Italian words, it doesn't make you bad. It's just providing access to the good stuff for you. To say it's a da capo aria is like being able to go to Starbucks and saying, I'd rather have a cappuccino than a cup of rotten coffee. The foreignness of it, same with cappuccinos, basically. And then there are, and this is the last thing, but I'll say this, and I appreciate Leia and Dimitri create a space where I can say this. I wouldn't really be able to say this at the Met. A lot of the people who will tell you this isn't for you are some other fans who can be a problem in this world, who can act like gatekeepers. Well, you don't really know what's going on. I'm here to tell you, as an official know-it-all, pay no attention to that, because I don't know anything. I know when I go there, what I feel like. When I was listening to the Verdi, I felt my blood racing. Verdi, does that to me. And I honor that. I honor, like, this is what I felt was going on with that music. And you can do that too. Now, I've spent 40 years in this business, so I've developed a vocabulary to defend what I've said, you know, what I feel. But the fact is, you can feel it the same as I can. So pay no attention to the gatekeepers. Now, we'll talk a little bit more about some of the canon, for lack of a better word. We're going to talk about Mozart, Verdi, Puccini and his friends, Wagner, that whole Wagner thing, and maybe even a little bit more, bring it into the present day. I do have one more slide that does bring us to the present day, don't I? Yeah, because we're making new operas now at a rate that probably would have made Verdi and Wagner gag with envy. Blue from Glimmerglass in 2019, which I haven't seen yet, but I've heard great things about, dealing with headline issues of today. And you'll see from the production there that they had the option of going for a somewhat realism-based way of telling the story, like real people that you might meet, like in La Boheme, and I'm sure the music goes with that. Or conversely, I just love this picture so much, 1985 isn't exactly modern, but Einstein on the beach at a Brooklyn Academy of Music, where they're all kind of working with the big computer in the sky for no reason, they just are. You can also, you have great opportunities today to express all these profound things in any number of ways, any number of dimensions, from realistic to romantic to avant-garde to outer space to pots and pans to anything else. So it's really, it's a great moment and you're in it. Leah.
Yes, sir.
Hello, Leah. I talked too much.
I heard you. I've been here all along. As you know, it's my sort of weekly adventure to be on my treadmill and listen to people talk about opera. It's kind of
the You just put in an hour on the treadmill, so massive respect.
Thank you. Thanks for, you know, going on an hour so that I like to make my 15,000 steps a day. I could talk to you all day about every nuance of opera. You have an in-depth understanding from the most basic things that I, you know, are so ingrained in some of us after studying it for so many years that we forget the basics and we forget why we feel the way we do, because we're so focused on production of the sound as singers or production of the piece as, you know,
getting the coloratura right in the right way. Yeah.
And yes, exactly. And we forget to tell the story sometimes. And so much of what you said today is so interesting that, you know, the Florentine Camerata did it by accident, right? Like that's
kind of like vulcanized rubber, one of these great inventions that happened by accident. Like, oh, I burnt the rubber. Say, that works well, you know.
Exactly. We're scientists and we forget that sometimes. We are the creators. And because, you know, we're doing Boheme and Boheme has been done however many thousands of times all over the world with amazing singers. And there's tradition now at this point, which is another brilliant thing that I think you said that I don't think we think a lot about. Music is created by the culture in which it was, I mean, the traditions of things are created because of the space where they were.
Yeah.
You said, you know, obviously Gullah culture and music is obviously written differently because of their surroundings than, you know, church music that was written to fill cathedrals, but that's it.
Yeah.
Tangentially, that's not neither here.
We'll get back to that, especially with Gullah for y'all in Charleston. Yeah.
In Charleston, I know. But we'll do Mozart another time, which is, that's next week, right? I think.
Yeah, or next time, which is not next week, I don't
think. Oh yeah, not next week. April 6th, everybody, get your calendars out. It's on the website, just also for the record. We'll be talking April 6th. What's all the fuss about Mozart? April 20th, why we're still all about Verdi. Goodness, I could get into that too. And why all the Verdi operas are the same, but we love them anyway. May 4th.
No, they're not. Don't listen to her.
May 4th is now this whole Wagner thing, and May 18th is ripping your guts out with Puccini and friends. So join us for all those classes. But I need to know, because we're in Charleston, you said the Dock Street Theater was your favorite theater, and I need to know why.
You feel the moments in between the notes. And Susanna Phillips was talking about, we did a webinar, and she was saying, you know, those, the in-between moments are the only time I get to hear the audience or feel or sense the audience and recalibrate what I'm doing. So it's like, it's the, well, pardon me, but it's the lovemaking moment. It's the point of contact between stage and auditorium. And I felt that, I not only felt that in a great way in Dock Street, but I also felt the hundreds of years of that. I mean, I love an old theater because the echo is still there.
Yeah.
And there was, you know, here's like this gem in America, and it's, hey, you know, that's something.
Yeah, it's we're exploring that deeply, obviously, here as we're bringing opera back to where it started. But that's interesting. That was another point I wanted to talk to you about is the moment between the notes. So many people who say, "Ugh, opera, that's not my thing," and I say, you know, "Oh, what have you seen that makes you feel that way?" And they say, "Well, I've never seen an opera." And so it's even starting from there that is talking about all the things. If I say, what elements don't you like? Is it the music? Is it the acting? Is it the, you know, what you, your impression you have from Bugs Bunny? Like, what is it about it that isn't for you? And most often what I hear people say is, you know, I don't understand the language, which you have demystified for us.
Neither did they.
Opera, right?
That's, you're not expected to. Yeah.
And then I don't know anything about the classical music. Well, also that is not a significant point, but it's the moments in between all the things you don't like. If you can wait for the all the things you think you don't like, if you can wait for the moments in between to breathe and conceptualize it all, and take it all in, I think that is a really interesting way to sell opera to people who say they don't like it.
I think in our eagerness to deflate the elitism label, we've taken a wrong direction. By we, I mean performing arts professionals and marketing and whatever. I want to say to people, it is an elite art form, not the way they told you it was. You don't need a lorgnette. I have never once seen a woman with a lorgnette other than Mrs. Howell on Gilligan's Island, except in movies where they go to the opera.
Right.
Because they want, it's invested that we have to believe there's this place where people wear lorgnettes. They should only. But it is elite. You do have to sit up and pay attention in a way. You can. That's the good news, no matter who you are. But this is not, this is going to demand a certain something from you. And I think we're at a point where all of us in opera companies from Charleston to San Francisco to the Metropolitan need to let people know that. Yeah, we're asking a lot. Some of these are really long. And you may need a little information about, all right, you know, I start every single broadcast I do with the 411 on this opera. This opera premiered in Venice in 1832. That's a lot of information right there. Mm. You know, so It's a lot the way it is because it was premiered for Venice in 1832, which you may or may not know, but it's worth considering that they had, what's the right word? Exigencies. They had needs and issues and stuff. So it is foreign in time and place. You can get there, but I need your elite self, whoever you are, to come here to engage with it.
Well, and I know opera, for some reason, when we use the word elite in regards to opera, it's a bad thing. And yet when we use the word elite in reference to athletes, it's the most amazing thing in the world. Like, they
we apply a lot of the, right? The things that we put towards sports, if we applied that to opera, we would learn a lot and we would access a lot.
Go on. I love unpack that.
There, said it. Come back next week.
No, but that's it, right? Like, that's that.
Well, also, but I mean, you know, you have to believe that they're being elite for you, not at you.
Right.
That she's hitting those notes because I can't. My mother used to say that about, people would say, why are you going to see Otello again? And she said, because that score says everything I can't. And it's like, constant. It's worth considering that, you know, who that person is up on the stage. Is that somebody who's speaking for you or performing some sort of rite for you? Or telling you you're too stupid and poor to understand? No. So try and see how that person is your voice. And we'll talk about that, I think, with Verdi, where each of the voices, like Aida is a soprano, but she's not just, she doesn't just represent the young women in the audience. She represents the voice you have that must be heard. When she shuts everyone up in the triumphal scene with 200 people on stage and three orchestras going at each other, pit, stage, and backstage, and she comes out and hits a high B flat and everybody shuts up. It's the most subversive political thing you've ever seen in your, heard in your life, because she is the most unimportant person, supposedly, on that stage. She's a slave. And there are kings, there are two kings, there's a high priestess, a high priest, a general, all the armies, nations, all these important things. And she says, whoa, what about me? And because she's a woman and she has that voice and Verdi knew how to put it, everyone shuts up and goes, whoa, what about Aida? And I gasp every time, because you have that voice too. You have that voice that must be heard. I have the soprano voice in me. We had that in the baritones in the Figaro, the baritone thinking voice. But wait, that's the sound of a baritone voice. You have that as a woman in you. No one can hear it when you open your mouth, but it strikes a chord. You know how, like, on a piano, you ever play the fuzz test where you, like, oh, moms of America get mad when I do this, but you pick up some lint off the carpet and put it on a couple of notes and you hit a note and look at what fuzz vibrates on the other keys. And those are the overtones and undertones. You have a fuzz test in you with all the voices, the high and low notes. And the opera characters within a good opera are playing on your inner notes. You're the harp of the piano with the fuzz on it.
Well,
so I want people to feel that direct connection, because you can.
And that's the magic, right? It is an individualized experience for each.
It's visceral, it's intellectual, it is spiritual.
And the reason you have to go more than once is because you don't wake up the same every day.
Now let's, and we'll talk about that, especially with Puccini, but, you know, every performance is a completely different context. Therefore, as we learned in Un ballo in maschera, therefore the thing itself that you're observing is different. You're different. You can't step in the same river twice. But beyond that, different production, different performance, different conductor, changes everything. Oof. Oh, Claudio Abbado, oh, Claudio Abbado. I was a big fan, so yeah. And it's not, fun fact, I've done more live performances, broadcasts of La Boheme than anyone in history, including Milton Cross, who did it for like 70 years or whatever it was. Aww. 62. Never once have I not had the moment of going, I never noticed that before. And that's just the broadcasts I've done. Never mind how many performances, as you say, have I been in and rehearsals. And it, no, it's a completely different. So that's, but that's another thing we need to talk about. It's like, wait, you're going to see Rigoletto again? Yeah, and so are you.
Well, and that's the thing that you, if we can understand that every day you wake up, if we have idiomatic expressions like waking up on the wrong side of the bed, that implies that every day is different. And that is the same thing with live theater, right? With opera. Every emotion is different. Every person, every day, you come, you bring a different sense of yourself. You have a different audience. You have different connections. Sometimes props are going to fly off the stage. Sometimes everything is going to be perfect. And you walk off the stage and think, wow, that was an ideal experience. That will happen literally never again in my life.
With the same cast and production and everything, yeah, on a different night. Yeah.
Yes. And magic. It's magic. That's what
there has to be a certain amount of quality to the piece to bear that. And that's why we have these things called the classics. And because they bear repeated listening, some things don't. And, you know, I always have the classic rock station on, and there are some songs that are new every time I hear them. And there are some that, frankly, I don't need to hear again. That, you know, having heard some of these that are just a simple chord progression, it was fine in the moment for driving down the street. There's no reason. It's done. It's played.
Does that make you say I'm never going to listen to any rock music ever again?
No. But
you say I won't listen to that song.
I need to hear Baby Hold On to Me one more time. I don't. Maybe you do. Sorry, Money fans. Love the fun, love the party music. But you're going to give me a chord progression. You better give me something in it that's just going to tell me why I need to hear that at different points in my life. And some people do, and some people don't. Earlier, we talked about Figaro and the thinking music. And the analog to that, interestingly, is if you're familiar with When the Levee Breaks, Led Zeppelin, the melody is in the rhythm. The drums play the melody and the guitar is just a drone, so it's the rhythm. And then the vocals are like random. So it's the world turned upside down, which is in fact the story it's telling. Like when the water is above the land, you're going to be in trouble. And it's in the music. It's just where the dots are. And that's exact. It's the same thing of playing with. You have that simple chord. Dun, 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 dun. And that's it. But that's not it. Because let me tell you, we'll hear it in 2 weeks and you'll be like, huh, I had a different experience of that. I can guarantee that.
Sort of along those lines with moving opera into a sort of contemporary realm. Obviously, there aren't a lot of operas being written now that are set in the past. There are a lot of things being written now that are sort of about now. No, you disagree with that. So how do you feel about setting, you know, this is the sort of on the gatekeeper side of what you're saying. There are a lot of traditionalists who can't see Boheme unless it's snowing on the stage in the Zeffirelli production. But I don't know that a lot of people can relate to that. And I think there's about to be a huge surge of like, Well, you might not be able to relate to TB, but you sure can relate to COVID, you know? And I'm just curious what your thoughts are as far as...
What a grotesque analogy, but apt. But
stories, right? But like, but bringing the stories, what you said, you know, what they did in, again, Florentine Camerata time, they said they wanted to revive Greek theater, but they didn't revive it in Greek. They revived it in Italian. They revived it
with their contemporary music.
Right. And mm-hmm. So that concept, if that's how it was born, that is sort of how we need to be continuing. I think we get to move on from, you know, telling the story. The stories are timeless. So many of these things, and obviously there are some things that can't be taken out of their immediate context within the show, kings and princes and whatever, but we still have those, right? We have our own royal drama going on currently.
There's an opera. attention, composers. What is important is not the literal context. What is important is that people can see their own stories in it. Now, that may or may not mean that the people on the stage look like them or are dressed like them. It may not. But the Florentine Renaissance people knew that the story of Apollo and Daphne was not a story of back then, because it never happened. They didn't believe in Greek gods in Florence in 1597. They knew it was a psychological story that we all carry with us, as Freud knew with Greek myths, that these are not stories of then and there. These are stories of here and now. And they put them in what they thought were Greek myth outfits in order to say, this is not a Greek myth. Do you know what I mean? And the same with what we call traditional in a lot of opera. There's a mythical past of opera that exists only on the operatic stage. It's usually 16th century and big skirts and cod pieces and this sort of thing. It's not historically accurate. It's not meant to be. Zeffirelli's Falstaff, which was great in its time, but Falstaff did not dress like Elizabethan people. Falstaff took place in the year 1400. So it's very Monty Python with the cap on, you know, bring out your dead. It's not going to look like what you want it to look like. What he did, his accomplishment, was not being traditional or accurate. His accomplishment was creating a separate mythology on the stage, where the absurdity of the world of Falstaff can happen, can be plausible. We have this place in opera called Seville, where half of the operas take place in Seville. It's not Seville. I've been to Seville. Seville's beautiful, but not like that. But there's this magic Seville of the mind that exists in the opera house, where certain things are possible, where you can make love to lots and lots and lots and lots of women, or try. In a way that I wouldn't recommend trying in Seville, least of all in the 16th century. We have outer space, where you want to set a movie where things can happen that can't happen with the people next door. We have outer space. We do this with movies perfectly well. We do this, you know, right away. You walk in and you know what the dimensions are of the possibilities of the world you're about to enter right away, from the music, the graphics. You have a sunset, you have a pretty woman, you know, oh wow, here comes Sandra Bullock and we're gonna have a rom-com, maybe some like Ed Sheeran music going on. You've got all the cues you need to say, this is going to be a story about people I might know that are sort of romanticized versions of me, but not, you know, or whatever. Whereas you go in and you hear, bum, 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 bum. Listen to those intervals. It's hoya to ho, right? This is not reality, right? And then they tell you with the graphics, a long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away, not next door, things can happen. I can move through time and space, and I can have friends of different species and talk to them in ways that Sandra Bullock can't. And we do the same thing at the opera, but how do you do that with the work from Venice in 1650 to an audience that walks in right away with all of its red lights on, like, wait, I'm not going to like this. It's really hard. And for different people in the audience, that if I'm going to create a mythical space for the person who wants to see a big skirt and a codpiece in order to enter into that space, or a person who wants to see anything but that at the same time, well, that's tricky. But that's what the issue is here. The issue is, what's the thing? What's going on up there? What language are they using? And I don't mean Italian, although that too. I mean, what's the language of this text that they're giving me right now? And I think we all need to broaden up a little bit. I think we need to, we in the audience and in the marketing departments, we need to up our game a little bit. And in the media and critics, it's not about, we have to look beyond, what's my gripe with what I'm seeing on stage? Is it because it's traditional or avant-garde, or because I'm just not connecting? As my late aunt would have said in Brooklyn, eh.
I feel like we've solved the problems of the world. That's great. Dust off the hands and we have an opera.
I feel like I need snacks.
Excellent. William Berger, thank you so, so, so much for joining us today.
I can't wait to get into some Mozart, because that's really like, you know, Mozart beyond the foot, like, yeah, he wore a powdered wig. That's not a problem. That's got no, you know what I mean? There's a lot to talk about here.
We will unpack that and more on April 6th. Everyone, please join us. As always, if anybody has questions, please send them to us at info@holycityarts.org. We have a lot of really big, exciting stuff that's coming up for the spring. Book your social distancing concerts. Send us emails. Go check out what we're doing outside as the weather warms up. And, you know, just send us love notes in general. Let us know what you want to hear. Let us know what you don't want to hear. And just keep the comments coming in. We are growing Halo for our audience, not for our kings. Although, you know, if anybody's got any kings around to pay for the opera, let's do that.
Who's got to pay for this stuff?
Thank you, Ashley, so, so much. And we'll see everybody next Tuesday at 2 p.m. Thanks, everyone.